longest abiding obstacle for anyone recommending the output of Yngwie Malmsteen to an acquaintance is the common misconception that he's a noodler and nothing else, the egomaniacal sultan of all show-offs, who's built the entirety of his songwriting output around and exclusively in service to his jaw-dropping fretboard acrobatics. The entire reason I'm devoting an episode of Metal Mythos to the Malmsteen monolith is because nothing could be further from the truth. And I think that misconception begins with Rising Force. Metalheads have a tendency to start at the beginning as a rule, and why wouldn't they, when so many once great bands from Maiden to Metallica enjoyed their most sustained outbursts of creativity at the very beginning, before successfully courting a fair damsel by the name of mainstream radio play for the bargain price of their cock balls and musical credibility. But as the man himself has said, there are three approaches to any given problem: the right way, the wrong way, and the Yngwie. If you're a leering hipster looking to justify your belief that the Swedish guitar god is nothing more than a technician with no sense of melody, timing, or the ability to say when, 1984's Rising Force will reinforce that opinion with adamantium fucking rebar. But you have to consider the time frame here. Yngwie was discovered as the prodigy guitarist in Ron Keel's Steeler, whereupon Ron Keel resented Yngwie's self-flagellating guitar heroics and reined him in at every available fucking opportunity. He didn't allow Yngwie to write a solitary note of music on their debut album, and even threw out some of the most brilliant takes of his guitar solos. After hopping off that train bound for exactly nowhere, he landed in Alcatraz, where Graham Bonnet encouraged Yngwie to write songs, then chided and resented him for upstaging the entire fucking band as a result. At every turn, Yngwie was encouraged to fly, then remonstrated for doing so. They wanted his talent, but they wanted it on a leash.
With a band called Steeler, and the singer was basically the leader and sort of the, you know, the main driving force in that band. And I wasn't gonna interfere with that. All I did was I just came into the band. When I hit the stage, I did what I did. Then I joined Alcatraz, and the same thing happened with Graham Bonnet. He got very upset. What the f*** is this guy doing, stealing my show?
Rising Force, consequently, is a grotesque overcorrection on Yngwie's part. 40 minutes of nearly uninterrupted instrumentals crafted for the singular purpose of showing the fuck off, which is fine. This was originally intended as a simple side project from Alcatraz. It stands to reason that only two of these songs would have vocals, particularly when the man providing the vocals, if you feel comfortable referring to him as such, is my mortal enemy Jeff Scott Soto, with falsetto Muppet voice in full fucking effect. Soda! Best track? Kinda difficult to pick out one in a solid block of guitar wankery such as this, but Evil Eye sees the maestro conducting some early field research in the realm of guitar harmony. It's a shame on a lot of levels that Yngwie was never hip to the idea of hiring a rhythm guitarist, because over the course of his career, Mr. Malmsteen penned more than a few tunes with rich guitar harmonies that sadly will never be performed in a live setting as a result. Worst song? Now Your Ships Are Burned. No drive, no songwriting, not one single memorable moment, and worst of all, Jeff Scott Soto's voice is on it. The Force had risen, alright, but the songwriting most certainly fucking hadn't. The question on everyone's lips, at least the lips of those who didn't chuck the album into an incinerator after the first 15 minutes of noodly indulgent bullshit, was whether or not Yngwie could actually write a proper metal album, something that employed more than his fretboard and his ego. And in 1985, Yngwie marshaled his rising force and marched on those motherfuckers. Before we progress with the second and final full studio album that he's featured on, I should probably explain my irrational hatred for Jeff Scott Soto. It's not that I hate him as a human being. By all accounts, he's down to earth and humble, which makes sense. He has plenty to be humble about. But it's not even that he's necessarily the worst vocalist to grace the verdant climes of 80s metal, but he's just so mind-bendingly, reality-smashingly, universe-implodingly motherfucking generic. If I were to close my eyes right this moment and attempt to conjure a perfect audio manifestation of the least distinctive, utterly mediocre metal voice in existence, not a quarter of a 16th of a 1,000th of a second would elapse before Jeff Scott Soto's Muppet falsetto was ringing in my ears. That said, on marching out, Jeff Scott Soto comports himself admirably. credit where it's due. Best song, Soldier Without Faith. And believe it or not, I give this recommendation in no small part due to Jeff Scott Soto's vocal performance. Gotta get out of here. Even a talentless clock is right twice a day. Marching Out is a tour de force, with the lone turd of the hour represented by the tiresome instrumental Overture 1383. Ploddingly slow, nothing more than a showcase for Yngwie's peerless vibrato. There's simply no reason for this song to exist at all. Really, my only thought while the runaway locomotive that is Marching Out is tearing down the tracks is how much fucking better it would be with a different fucking conductor. There's genius here, and no mistake, but as killer as it is, you got the niggling feeling Yngwie was holding something back. And Mother Mary's pert titties was he ever. Classic 80s metal band had their breakout moment, their British Steel or Ace of Spades moment. For the Wing Nut, that moment materialized in 1986's White Hot Manifesto by the name of Trilogy. Marching Out, for all its fretboard histrionics, surprised everyone by very nearly managing to crack the Billboard Top 50. Granted, in 2014, not such a big deal. Hell, in the age of piracy, I'm reasonably certain I've recorded answering machine messages that have cracked the top 40. But in 86, when the charts actually meant something, no mean feat. Yngwie caught a faint whiff of that pop metal money train as it passed him in the night, and he wanted more. Consequently, Trilogy is considerably more commercial in approach, as exemplified by the infectious, anthemic You Don't Remember, I'll Never Forget. And oh, tragedy of tragedies, halfway through the Marching Out tour, Jeff Scott Soto took his afro and wafer-thin voice on back to Sesame Street, whereupon Yngwie made one of the most profound upgrades in the history of metal by hiring the wig-bedecked, openly gay, former Ted Nugent bassist with the strongest set of pipes this side of Ripper Owens, a man named Mark Bowles, who positively tears through the material on Trilogy with a pitch-perfect technical precision that perfectly mirrors Yngwie's own. While he's not my personal favorite Yngwie singer, he's widely considered to be the best, and on this album, it's virtually impossible to argue. Best song, look, this album's damn near perfect, so throw a dart, but my personal favorite will always be the thudding, rhythmic riffage of Queen Is In Love. It's contagious, pounding pop metal of the highest possible order, and further proof that Yngwie Malmsteen, the songwriter, is easily the single most underrated motherfucker in the history of the genre. Worst song? Well, it's not necessarily bad, but the downpaced Crying is just another sappy instrumental ballad in the vein of Overture 1383. It's more an exercise in atmospherics than metal majesty, and it accomplishes that successfully, but it's simply not my cup of vodka. Trilogy! A truly underrated, out-and-out classic that deserves a spot right alongside albums like Number of the Beast and Wheels of Steel in the highest halls of seminal heavy metal statements. Listen to this fucking record. But did the honeymoon last, I hear you asking aloud. You and I both know Yngwie doesn't do honeymoons. Unless that happens to be the name of a pastry. Next! Locked up in chains, back to the wall, just like the time bomb. About halfway through the tour for Trilogy, Mark Bowles filled the tank on Yngwie's coked-up bullshit and walked out on the band, only to be replaced by He Who Shall Not Be Named, who in a spasm of common sense, Yngwie also fired, until Malmsteen finally settled on arguably the greatest AOR singer of the 1980s, former Rainbow and future Deep Purple frontman Joe Lynn Turner. And just as the lineup began to congeal, shit went Yngwie. Setting aside the guitar, the Yngwie Malmsteen of yore afforded his undivided affection to just two things: high-end sports cars, and vodka. You don't have to be a nuclear physicist to surmise that story wasn't going to have a happy ending. What no one could have foreseen prior to June 27th, 1987, when Yngwie wrapped his cream-colored V12 Jaguar E-Type around a tree, yes, the very same car featured in the video for You Don't Remember, was that it was only the beginning of a two-year period of protracted misery for the maestro. First things first, Yngwie very nearly died. And when I say very nearly, I mean literally died for a moment. And in the aftermath, we're talking swelling of the brain, comatose for a full week, near death, bookended by an intense 6-week regimen of physical therapy during which it was revealed that his right hand could no longer even firmly take hold of a guitar pick. And the hits just kept on coming, as not long after his mother would die after a long withering illness back home in Sweden, followed shortly thereafter by the death of his brother, and just weeks before that, a 5.9 earthquake struck LA, all but demolishing Yngwie's palatial Hollywood mansion. The man was understandably devastated. Upon completion of his physical therapy, Yngwie reportedly couldn't even pick up a guitar out of crippling fear that he'd lost his mojo. But with the clock ticking and the record company beating down his door, along with the timely realization that his longtime manager had stolen all of his fucking money, he re-entered the studio, and in 1988, out popped Odyssey. A thunderous release, rife with the most blistering guitar work of his career to date, and positively festooned with hair metal anthems. As such, the album would prove to be the highest charting, best-selling album of his career, and arguably the most merciless comeback in the history of metal. Yngwie hadn't just recovered, his abilities had easily doubled, as Odyssey features easily the most fly-by-wire, laser-precise guitar work to that point. But fuck the guitar playing, because from top to bottom, as a songwriter, Odyssey is one of his finest offerings. Best track for me, it's the Infernal Psalm by the name of Deja Vu. The perfect exemplification of the Joe Lynn Turner Yngwie Malmsteen collaboration. The raw catchiness of hair metal cohabitating with Yngwie's neoclassical affectations, and as adverse as the pairing sounds at face value, it fits like Joe Lynn Turner's bald skull into one of those goofy wig helmets he's always fucking wearing. The worst thing you can say for Odyssey is that it does kind of suffer from a small amount of filler, personified in the form of tracks like Faster Than the Speed of Light, and ode to the high-yield sports cars that had nearly fucking murdered him a year beforehand. Oh, Yngwie, never fucking change. Odyssey, the poppiest Yngwie affair by far, but a period during which Yngwie Malmsteen, the solo artist, began to give way to Yngwie Malmsteen's rising force, the actual band, a welcome pattern that would continue over the next few releases and result in some of the finest power metal tinged hair metal AOR releases ever committed to tape. Arguably the finest hour of Joe Lynn Turner's career, and certainly among the upper echelons of Yngwie's output. Unashamedly recommended. Ah, but the honeymoon of the honeymoon of the honeymoon was not to last.
Is this going to be a long-standing relationship? That's what I want to know.
We hope so, but you know, you get married, you don't know what happens.
But I didn't know you guys were married.
Secretly.
Oh. It doesn't say that on the album. Where does it say you married each other?
If Trilogy had seen a light flirtation with commerciality and Odyssey had ignited into a full-blown love affair, the 1990s pristine hair metal masterpiece by the name of Eclipse is where that relationship blossomed into maturity. This is a controversial album for Malmsteen aficionados, but not for yours truly. To my ears, Eclipse is the finest record Yngwie Malmsteen has ever pressed to a fucking disc. With Yngwie's well-publicized creative spats with Joe Lynn Turner adorning music magazines the world over, and the newly reformed Deep Purple lineup in need of a new singer, anyways, the Wingnut enlisted who is, for my money, the single most talented, diverse, and soulful vocalist he ever employed.
The new singer is called Göran Edman. I just found these guys very, very good. They're all Swedish. The whole band is Swedish. We are really getting along very well.
After ditching King Diamond's semi-retarded cousin in Jeff Scott Soto for a third time, losing the raw power of Mark Bowles, and finally the pompous AOR crooning of Joe Lynn Turner, for me at least, it was a refreshing change of pace to hear Yngwie paired with a heavy metal singer so clearly inspired by the likes of Motown, Michael Jackson, and Stevie Wonder. The indomitable Göran Edman still possesses unbridled power and range in the upper registers, but with a smoothness and a bluesy timbre rarely found outside of Paul Rogers, Glenn Hughes, or Don Dokken. Eclipse, for my money, is the first example of Yngwie Malmsteen as a full-fledged band. While every song is credited to Yngwie himself for greedy publishing rights reasons that will soon bite him in his rapidly swelling ass, in actuality this record sees an unparalleled amount of collaboration between all members of the band, and consequently Eclipse ranks as perhaps the most creatively daring release in the entire Malmsteen catalog, a phenomenon that flowers into full rising force on tracks like the LA Earthquake-inspired song Fault Line, which remains perhaps the single greatest experiment in rich guitar harmonies and more subdued, mature songwriting that Yngwie Malmsteen has ever recorded. As such, there isn't a worse track here. I love literally every note of this album, and the production, while somewhat thin, is thin by necessity and thick with reverb, lending to the omnipresent, dreamy, fantastical atmosphere of Eclipse. From Malmsteen fanboys, there was a lingering belief that Eclipse, while an undoubtedly good album, was a disappointment next to Odyssey, and those people are what the French would call fucking wrong. It's Odyssey without all the filler, and I'll say it, with a better fucking singer. Fucking deal with it. Eclipse, emphatically recommended. Next. While sonically speaking it shares virtually nothing in common with Judas Priest's Painkiller record, Eclipse shared a similar fate commercially, namely that it was a victim of the time in which it was produced. Heavy metal just wasn't cool in 1990, so some of the best produced, most searingly performed, and musically diverse music of Yngwie Malmsteen's career went effectively ignored. At this period in his career, Yngwie found himself at a crossroads. Down one path lay the more commercial climbs of early 90s hair metal, which, while fading, was still paying the freight and then some for successful bands of the era like Def Leppard, Warrant, and Firehouse. And down the other, the towering peaks of Yngwie's own unique brand of neoclassically tinged power metal. He decided, incidentally, to push hard in both directions. As such, there are two diametrically opposed songs that I have to say are frankly tied for best track on the next album, Fire and Ice, with the hair metal side represented by the moody and atmospheric pop metal stylings of Cry No More, and perhaps Yngwie's most garish, unrepentant exploration of symphonic metal to that point, the superb album closer, The Final Curtain. Tracks? There really aren't any here, but I will say the album's most head-scratching moment is when it opens the fuck up with a fucking instrumental, and not even a headbanger a la Trilogy Suite, a fairly ponderous, plodding, bloated affair entitled Perpetual, which given Yngwie's weight at this point, I have to believe refers to his perpetual ingestion of salted cured deli meats.
No, I don't eat donuts.
I don't like fucking donuts, alright?
Hostile.
Not a terrible song, but absolutely fucking not a track to open an otherwise incredible symphonic pop metal album with. A near perfect note on which to conclude the hair metal Malmsteen experiment. Next! After Fire and Ice was utterly obliterated by the grunge rock thermonuclear explosion of 1992, Elektra Records dropped the band after just one album, and to make matters worse, you know those publishing rights shenanigans I mentioned on Eclipse? Well, an Yngwie singer finally caught on when Göran Edman came to collect by openly suing Yngwie Malmsteen and his management for unpaid royalties of the songs he had co-written. The good news? He eventually won and cleaned the fuck up. The bad news? My favorite metal singer and Yngwie Malmsteen had a parting of the ways that proved to be permanent. Göran was promptly replaced by a more traditional, operatically influenced powerhouse of a singer named Mike Viscara, best known perhaps for his time fronting the Japanese metal legends known as Loudness. Generic? No fucking doubt, but he's a 15-mile walk from Jeff Scott Soto's mediocre muppetry. The Seventh Sign, while not in my opinion necessarily a superior album to Eclipse, Odyssey, or Fire and Ice, was a much-needed infusion of those latent power metal sword and sorcery Frodo and the Ring underpinnings of Yngwie's youth that had fallen by the wayside in his fruitless pursuit of commercial acceptance. It's a bedrock solid album, positively rife with soaring fantasy metal anthems and speed metal savagery, but it's also not completely out of Fire and Ice territory just yet, which would be great if Jöran Edman were still singing in this band, but he ain't. And when Mike Mascara sings power ballads like the biggest turd on this record, Forever One, he sounds like a pterodactyl with a sinus infection. Best track, Crash and Burn, a song that only amplifies in impact the more you learn about Yngwie's life during this period. His mother, brother, and manager all died in the same two-year period during which his searingly hot wife, Erika Norberg, filed for divorce and was dropped from not one but two record labels, losing the entirety of his multi-million dollar fortune in the process. Crash and Burn is the sound of a shattered Yngwie Malmsteen raising his head, taking stock of his situation, and saying, I'm alive, world. Fuck you in the ass. You took your mission. The Seventh Sign represents an uncontested highlight in Yngwie Malmsteen's discography and marks the precise moment at which he explicitly chose personal fulfillment over the nebulous promise of eventual fiduciary success. Although in Japan, at least, he had plenty of that, with the Seventh Sign ultimately going platinum six fucking times, eclipsing any other Western artist before or since. For scope, the closest possible competition is Mariah Carey, with less than half that number sold in Japan. My only gripe, pop metal has its faults, but in Yngwie's case at least, it resulted in some of the most refreshing experimentation of his career, and without question, the most collaborative output he ever recorded outside of Alcatraz. The Seventh Sign, for all its virtues, marks the definitive death of that freewheel pioneering spirit, and I feel eventually resulted in the wing nut settling into something of a wing rut. That was a terrible pun. Yngwie Malmsteen, the band, is dead. Long live Yngwie Malmsteen, the solo artist. Next. The birth of Yngwie Beardsteen. So yeah, it's a good thing Yngwie wrote a song named Leviathan, because by 1995, he was about the fucking size of one. Which sadly in the music press seemed to overshadow every solitary thing about this album, which is a crying shame because as a pure musical work, Magnum Opus may well be the best thing Yngwie Malmsteen has ever recorded in his fucking life. For the moment this album tears through your speakers with a song aptly titled Vengeance, it seems constructed for the lone purpose of topping the Seventh Sign in every conceivable respect. And that it fucking does. Departing from the pack is the scorching speed metal symphony by the name of Fire in the Sky, which readily ranks as one of the finest epics of the man's career. Worst track? Amber Dawn, on a lot of levels. So at this point, I should probably address the elephant in the room. No, not Yngwie himself. Around this time, Yngwie achieved perhaps the greatest fame of his career as a prominent celebrity example of spousal abuse. He was married to a woman, strangely enough, from right here in Phoenix, and in the surprise of the microsecond, her name was Amber Dawn. So here's the thing. There's pretty much three entire chapters of the unauthorized Yngwie biography devoted to all this drama. So here's the short, I give less than a fuck about celebrity gossip version of the story. Amber fucked the band singer, Mike Mascara. Yngwie, having been consistently high as a coked out kite and perpetually shit-faced since roughly 1985, found out, punched a wall, and obliterated his picking hand, at which point Amber's mother, in an effort to blackmail Yngwie to acquire his newly reacquired multi-million dollar fortune, called his SWAT team to his home, claiming the injury had been sustained when he broke Amber's jaw, despite her complete lack of physical injuries. Trial ensues. Tens of thousands of legal fees later, the court realizes Amber's mom is a functioning schizophrenic who wants to get paid, and he's acquitted. When the dust had cleared, Yngwie Malmsteen needed a new singer and a new wife. See, that wasn't so hard, at least not any harder than Mike Mascara's dick around married women. Magnum Opus! The album during which all that bullshit happened, and an unfairly ignored album for precisely that reason. Unendingly superior to The Seventh Sign, which is no fucking slouch either. Don't be a cock. Listen to this fucking record. Next. For me, Facing the Animal is the last documented occurrence in Yngwie Malmsteen's career where he actually made a calculated, concerted attempt to incorporate more contemporary elements into his music, which is a Greek fucking tragedy when you think about it, folks. Just ponder this for a moment. Yngwie melds his unique neoclassical affectations with traditional heavy metal. The album's name is Trilogy, and it's a fucking masterpiece. When he folded his Bach and Mozart worship in with late 80s, early 90s hair metal, you get Eclipse, Fire and Ice, and Odyssey, an uncontested triumvirate of unrivaled perfection. And here in 1997, Yngwie attempts to fuse his omnipresent arpeggio-laden Baroque badassery with a light peppering of late 90s mainstays like grunge, hard rock, and even nu metal, and surprise, it's a fucking masterpiece. With Yngwie at long last encountering his current wife, the preposterously attractive print model April Malmsteen, he finally had a stable enough familial influence that he could get the fuck clean. Consequently, the themes of this album, as not so subtly suggested by its title, chronicle Yngwie slaying his plethora of personal demons. Looking for a replacement singer who could keep his octaves high and his prick sheathed around his wife, he stumbled on a glass-shattering Weird Al Yankovic lookalike named Mats Levin, who doom metal aficionados will note as the current vocalist of Candlemass, with a trademark Soundgarden-esque sandpaper shriek that shockingly does not evaporate when he soars into the higher registers. Mats Levin is easily one of the most bafflingly talented vocalists ever to join the ranks of the rising force, displayed with dazzling technical brilliance on what is, for my money, one of the album's very finest cuts, Sacrifice. Facing the Animal, easily one of the most artistically daring, refreshing takes on 90s metal ever printed, but sadly, like similarly bitchin' albums of its era, it fell victim to a merciless bastard named 1997. Much more importantly, though, Yngwie was off the junk and back in the driver's seat. This record kills, and you should fucking listen to it. Next. You know, I'm mortified to admit that the original cut of this episode of Metal Mythos did not actually include this album. My reasoning was fairly straightforward. While Yngwie Malmsteen's Concerto Suite in E minor is a historic moment in the development of both heavy metal and classical music, from a musical standpoint, it's less a proper album and more a collection of symphonic adaptations of his earlier instrumental material. Upon further review, there are actually more than a few original compositions here, and taken as a whole, the Concerto Suite in E minor serves as not only the crowning achievement of Yngwie Malmsteen's storied career, but a work of staggering genius in its own right. Remember, this was released in 98, a full year before Metallica's S&M experiment burned up the charts, and if we're objectively contrasting the extent to which each utilizes the actual orchestral dynamic, who in all of Christendom with two entire brain cells to carry a static charge is gonna say Metallica? I can't single out any individual tracks, as this quite obviously is intended as a seamless work, but I can and will recommend it to fans of both heavy metal and classical, of which I happen to belong to both. It's not a track-by-track triumph, but rather an indelible chapter of music history. You owe this at least one listen. Next. After two light flirtations with the genre in the mid-90s, a full-on symphony album, and at least one left-field detour in a late-90s radio metal, Alchemy would go down historically as Yngwie Malmsteen's very first full-bore power metal record. With a genre he may have single-handedly invented, gaining commercial and critical traction in Europe, Yngwie strapped on his cream-colored Strat, hoisted his middle finger aloft, and proclaimed, "No, motherfuckers, this is how you do it." And what better singer to employ for such an endeavor than the one who had helped you conceive the genre to begin with, the mind and speaker-blowing Mark Bowles. The result was Alchemy, perhaps the strongest single power metal release of the entirety of the 1990s, and I say that with every awareness. The quintessence of this album can be found in one of its many standouts, my favorite track, Wield My Sword. For fuck's sake, this album is so goddamn geeky, there is literally a line where Mark Bowles actually utters the words, "Fear not, my fair maiden." To attack, no demons or dragons will hold me back. The strength in my sword, fall into my... If you've ever played Dungeons and Dragons, Skyrim, or anything in the fuck else in that vein without simultaneously cranking this album, you cannot possibly be doing it right. Wake tracks? Fuck them. This album is a beast bent clean the fuck over from dragging its 10-ton cock and balls around for the first 1,000 years of its existence. Alchemy, music to behead orcs too. Next. Malmsteen, like myself and like many of you watching this, is a PC gamer, which should surprise exactly no one given how geeky his fucking music happens to be, and that's awesome, except that by the time everyone shuffled the fuck back into the studio to cut 2000's War to End All Wars album, well, it was the year 2000. I repeat, PC gamer, year 2000. Needless to say, Yngwie was hardly ever in the goddamn recording studio and delegated the responsibility of mixing the album to someone the fuck else. What game so preoccupied the wingnut, you ask? Well, it was 2000. Deus Ex, Thief 2, Asheron's Call, Mech Warrior 4, Star Trek Elite Force even. We can only speculate, but Scuttlebutt from Yngwie's unofficial autobiography says all signs point to Diablo fucking 2. That's right, asshole. If you logged into Battle.net at launch in 2000, you may very well have tangled with Yngwie fucking Malmsteen. Unfortunately, the recording itself suffered, and what we were left with was a brilliant collection of songs that sound like they were recorded in an aluminum outhouse down the street. Production quality aside, the highlights are Everest fucking high. My personal favorite, however, is a song originally recorded for Yngwie's Powerhouse demos all the way back in 1978 or 9, when he was still languishing in Sweden. A song originally called Merlin's Castle, finally belted the fuck out by the titanium lungs of Mark Bowles, as it always should have been. The Wizard Rips Ass, which I think technically makes it a proctomancer. There's no bad songs here as such. The only thing about this album that's a drizzling shits is the Fisher-Price tape deck it was fucking recorded on. The good news, Yngwie Malmsteen had crafted another killer of an album, albeit with production so bad it's entirely possible it literally killed people. Having capped off his third meeting with the maestro, the great Mark Bowles elected to make it his final, and that's the bad news. And he hung up his outlandishly unconvincing wig for good, forming his own band, the terminally underrated power metal powerhouse, Ring of Fire, leaving Yngwie without a frontman for only the 9 billionth time in the last 15 minutes. That is, until he remembered that there was at least one more rainbow singer that he hadn't yet stolen. Enter Doogie White! Never heard of him? Yeah, well, welcome to the exclusive club of fucking everyone. Yada yada, he sang on the final Rainbow album before Ritchie Blackmore decided to take his Vincent Price mustache and impossibly attractive girlfriend Candace Knight on over to the verdant climes of fucking medieval music. Hey, don't judge. You'd spend a lot of time at Renaissance festivals if that banging bitch was letting you wear her like an overcoat too, and don't deny it. Doogie turned in a respectable performance on the album that was ultimately overshadowed by frequent guest vocal appearances by said girlfriend. And that's really all you can say about the cat. Respectable. He can't hit dog whistle notes or bellow in the lower octaves, but he sings in key, takes care of his voice, and ducks Yngwie's Jackie Chan kicks on stage, so he already meets all of Yngwie's fucking requirements. I can't disparage Doogie-era Yngwie, but I'm not doing backflips thinking about it either. The resultant Attack album is half true. Yngwie Malmsteen himself? He's attacking like there's no tomorrow, and thanks to the vastly improved production quality compared to the junky Yard Symphony that was War to End All Wars, this performance is crystal clear. But Doogie, he's just kind of there. I mean, you have to feel for this bastard. He's a great metal singer in his own right, but he's following Mark Bowles. Joe Lynn Turner pulled off the same feat because he was already a household name after his one with Rainbow. But you ask most people what they think of Doogie, they're gonna say he's their favorite adolescent television doctor in the whole wide world. And nothing Doogie White does on this album is likely to reorient public perception either. Best track, I kinda dig Touch the Sky, as its catchy as cholera keyboard intro seems like a bit of a nod back to the hair metal Malmsteen days of Odyssey and Eclipse. Worst track? Fucking Freedom, which represents only the second time since the Seventh Sign's ill-conceived B-side Angel in Heat that Yngwie Malmsteen himself elected to sing. The only only freedom from this song is the sweet release of death. Attack, a title I can only assume was inspired by one of Yngwie's all-night salami blowouts. When Yngwie isn't making notes with his mouth, it's a solid, if unexceptional, effort. Recommended to power metal aficionados exclusively. Next. By 2004, Yngwie Malmsteen had fallen in public esteem. He was releasing middling albums with a singer that was merely okay, and confining himself primarily to European and Japanese tour dates as a result. And then an audio clip that was recorded, oddly enough, in 1989 during the Odyssey era, found its way onto everyone's favorite repository for non-metal and e-drama, Blabbermouth.net. The clip, recorded without Yngwie's knowledge, presumably by a member of his road crew, chronicled an event that took place on a flight bound for Tokyo, Japan, during which the Johansson brothers, notorious pranksters that they were, had caused trouble on the plane somehow, pissing off one of the stewardesses. When the stewardess headed back to first class to confront the culprits, all she saw was a room full of tall, long-haired Swedish dudes. She mistook a shit-hammered, and thus passed the fuck out, Yngwie Malmsteen for his keyboard player, Jens Johansson, and dumped a glass of ice water in his fucking head. And then, Yngwie's next album got a title.
I don't fucking deserve this shit! I paid for a first-class ticket, I don't need a fucking cunt come up to me and do that shit. See you in Tokyo, bitch. You release the fucking fury. You release the fucking fury. Forget about it.
See You in Tokyo, Bitch was released in 2000. I'm just fucking with you. Unleash the Fury, Rageaholics. And musically, at least, the album lives up to every syllable of its fucking title. A hypersonic headbanger from beginning to end that contains some of the most impressive high-wire guitar heroics of Yngwie's ever-loving career. Unfortunately, the name on the inside sleeve is Doogie White. Look, he's a more than competent frontman. Not the most dynamic figure on stage, but that's no vice when you're playing with this fucking band. I'm pretty sure if he could legally get away with it, Yngwie would lock the lead singer in a shark tank suspended 50 feet above the motherfucking stage, if at all possible. He doesn't like sharing the stage, and if he keeps knocking back the po' boys, it may rapidly turn into a physical impossibility. Look, a powerful album needs a powerful singer, and Doogie White was born to be mild. If I have one major grievance with this album, it's the inescapable feeling that Yngwie is quoting himself a bit. Track, the title track, without question, a slow monolithic build to one of Yngwie's patented atmospheric epics. Worst track, gonna have to say Crackin' the Whip, for the simple fact that this seemed to be the genesis of a modern phenomenon for the swollen Swede. His propensity for grabbing a mic and singing himself. Just. Say. No. Brilliant songwriting plus so-so singing equals a so-so album. Mild recommendation. After two albums spinning his wheels with Doogie White MD, it was time for Yngwie to get ripped. Let's light the perpetual flame, Rageaholics. With Yngwie brewing up another live one, Doogie White headed on back to Middle Earth to wrangle up some Long Bottom Leaf, but a chance collaboration on an Ozzy Osbourne tribute album led to the discovery of perhaps the most esteemed vocalist the Wingnut would ever work with, a man I spoke about at length in Metal Mythos number 1, the legendary Ripper Owens. Lending his ringwraith shrieks to Yngwie's blazing fretwork, the duo set about to unleash the fury for fucking real this time, and the end result did not fucking disappoint. Perpetual Flame is power metal Yngwie in the first degree. An album in the tradition of classics like The Seventh Sign and Magnum Opus that positively towers over both. He's revitalized. The breakneck pace is unremitting, and Ripper Owens is Ripper goddamn Owens. Mind you, if Ripper's voice were buried any deeper in the mix, he could probably dig up what was left of Yngwie's career by the time he joined the band. What the fuck, dude? Did you record your vocals in the ball pit at Chuck E. Cheese? Why does everyone Ripper works with want to drown this guy's voice in 9.5 trillion effects? But despite the needless compression and sounding like he's singing into a coffee can, Ripper Owens positively soars on this record, as illustrated in one of the album's innumerable fucking standouts, a merciless track you may remember shredding along to in Rock Band 2. Worst track, I'll go with Magic City, with an asterisk, that being that it's probably the one and only time in my life where I hear Yngwie sing and don't immediately want to punch him in the soul. My issue with this song isn't Yngwie singing, it's just the song itself. It's vaguely bluesy, a clear homage to Hendrix, but at 7.5 minutes, it wears out its welcome too sweet. Perpetual Flame, the comeback album Unleash the Fury should have been, and the absolute apex of modern Malmsteen. This shit belongs in your ear holes. Next! Celebrated as a rousing resurgence by virtually every corner of the music press imaginable, when Ripper and Yngwie re-entered the studio a year later to record the follow-up to Perpetual Flame, expectations were positively soaring. And then Relentless showed up, or alternately, meh the album. I don't know what the fuck happened here. On paper, you got Yngwie Malmsteen, you got Ripper Owens, two titans of modern metal who just rap recording on what was far and away Yngwie's finest album since Fire and Ice. And then this pops out. Make no mistake, Relentless isn't a ceaseless stream of diuretic turds, but it suffers from two of the more glaring failures of latter-day Yngwie. Vapid and unmemorable instrumentals out the ass, mouth, and ears, and a clown shoes fucking running order. I feel like Yngwie was probably hanging upside down when he compiled Relentless, because the second half of this album, paved with rock-solid fare like Axe to Grind, Tide of Desire, and Blinded, positively demolishes the opening half. Worst song? Gah, look at you now. No, Yngwie, how about listen to you now, buddy? Play your guitar, throw in the occasional bass part. If you're feeling spectacularly frugal that week, you can even record a drum part or two. But do not go anywhere near a live microphone with that singing voice. So help me, Yngwie, if you go anywhere near that vocal booth one more time, I will turn this episode right around and head right... Spellbound is a heinous sack of shit. While there's been no shortage of middling material from Yngwie in recent years, Spellbound represents Yngwie's first out-and-out shitty record in a long fucking while. And I'll say this much in the album's defense, the songwriting is not to blame here. There are some potent pieces of power metal on this shit pile. Poison Mind, Repent, Spellbound itself. But the X factor, as always, was who will be behind the mic. After successful collaborations with greats like Mark Bowles, Mike Viscara, Glenn Hughes, and Ripper Owens, when the album finally dropped, we were at last treated to the rafter-shaking, glass-shattering, full-voice tenor vocals of the cap that periodically gets fucked in the ass outside my window at 4 o'clock in the morning. I mean Yngwie Malmsteen himself. I don't know what the fuck that was, but it needs to blow its nose. Yngwie's vocals aren't shit, they eclipse shit. Post-shit, even. Yngwie, buddy, you're a god, but everyone knows God can't sing. Why the fuck do you think he took Freddie Mercury if he could? All I can think as I'm listening to the blues-laden groove of Let Sleeping Dogs Lie, for example, is how much fucking better it would be with one of your more soulful singers, like Göran Edman or Jolynn Turner, singing it instead of a vocal track that sounds like a congested panther. Worst song? I don't even... Look, this is just... Like if a septic main erupts beneath my house and I'm suddenly covered in 6 inches of an entire neighborhood's worth of putrid spinach green feculence, am I really gonna be singling out just one turd or another and saying, that's the motherfucker that broke the camel's back right there? This album is dick. Subdicular region, Tate and balls we're talking, but it's dick with some memorable instrumentals. I'll give it that much. Yngwie. Swallow your pride, open up the little black book, and hire a fucking singer already, pal. Nobody wanted to watch Michael Jordan play baseball, and nobody fucking wants to listen to you sing. And that Hispanic hobbit behind the keyboard you lug around on tour, go ahead and lose his fucking microphone. Yeah! That does it, Rageholics. Thank you for unleashing the fury with me, and you know damn well I shall return for future forays into the ethereal mists of the metal mythos. I'm Razor Fist. God fucking speed.
I like the way he puts Yngwie J. Malmsteen on his album, so you know you don't confuse him with all the other Yngwie Malmsteens in the business.